Namaskar from Homeopathic Medical Association of Telangana. Welcome to this special session during the period of this crisis of COVID-19 that is engulfed the whole globe. We have here on the panel very good speakers, some who are special all over the world as far as homeopathy is concerned. It was in the same month of May last year that we had Dr. Anil Khurana ji, Director General of Central Council for Research in Homeopathy, to speak at Hyderabad on a particular topic. And indeed, it has been a very tough kind of an year, in the sense that there have been many challenges for homeopathy, and we are going through some sort of that now. And on last occasion when Dr. Khurana was with us, we had called him the Superman of homeopathy, as he is the person who is head of the most number of homeopathic medical institutions in the world, the number of hospitals, the number of research institutes, the number of homeopaths who are around him, and the number of homeopathic associations who are in a glove with him at the wave of a hand. For any cause of homeopathy that is concerned. And that is the reason why we have here with us today the same gentleman who can help us to understand, to go through what is going on in the world of homeopathy. We homeopaths are in different boats as far as sailing towards the cause is concerned. But as far as the storm is concerned, we are all in the same storm. But what is steering us through, how the governing bodies of Central Council of Homeopathy are helping us through, is going to be given by Dr. Anil Khurana ji. And later we also have a very dynamic young gentleman, Dr. Anand Kulkarni, who is going to speak on the clinical trials topic that has been allotted to them. And I see all my teachers, all great people, Dr. Ashok Patil sir, and our team of HMAT, medical director and treasurer, Dr. Gopal Krishna Garu, and Drug Standardization Institute, Dr. Sundaram Garu, and we have Dr. Vashisht, our advisor. And I hand over the charge to Dr. Sampath Rao Garu.
Good evening, everybody. So let me not take more time of you. So world is facing a great, biggest crisis of the century. So due to the COVID-19 pandemic, health crisis, economic crisis, so the social crisis also, because of the social distance, lockdown, etc. And lakhs of people are dying because of this pandemic. All the temples are closed. Masjids, churches, gurudwaras, all religious worship places are closed. And now the people are looking towards only the living temples of the world and the living gods of the world. That is the hospitals, clinics, and towards the doctors and the health workers. So they have, the people of the world, they have great ray of hope on these soldiers, the health workers, who is going to bring them out of this COVID-19 pandemic crisis. So as the doctors, we have a great responsibility and role to play during this biggest problem of the century. There is a saying, whenever the problems they come, so there are two types of approaches. So keeping quiet and succumbing to the problem, and taking it as a challenge and finding the way out for this challenge. So as a homeopathic doctors, we have our role to play. Let us take this problem as a challenge and find the solution for the problem, and bail out the people from this great crisis. So to deliberate on this issue. We have the eminent speakers, our Director General of Central Council of Homeopathy, Research in Homeopathy, Dr. Anil Khuranaji. So as the President of the Association, sir, I welcome you with a gracious heart. And we have one more speaker, Dr. Anand Kulkarni, the principal of the BDJT Homeopathic Medical College, Dharwad of the Karnataka. I welcome you, the young Dr. Anand. With us, I hand over the mic to Dr. Venugopal Puri, General Secretary of the Homeopathic.
Sir, thank you so much, sir. I request Dr. Khuranaji to make his presentation, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. My dear colleague, homeopathic fraternity. And I will just make a small presentation from my side. Dr. Venkatesh, can you allow me to share my screen? Because it is hand up from your side. Dr. Venkatesh, can you just allow me to share my screen?
Sure, sir. Just a moment.
So at the outset, everyone knows that we are all going through a difficult situation. A pandemic which is there after a century. All of you know about this, the past pandemic of 1918 of Spanish flu. Almost more than 20 million people died at that point of time. It's not a small figure. In spite of so much of development, so much of health infrastructure available throughout the country, so much of connectivity, technical advancements in all kinds of health infrastructure, this pandemic has made us realize where we stand at this point of time, in spite of so much of advancements. Now, when we talk of this COVID-19, there is one small, you can say that homeopathy prophylaxis, which is an edge over any other kind of a preventive measure, although we are maintaining social distancing because of this lockdown, we could have imagined if this lockdown would not have been taken up at an appropriate time in India, what would have been the situation at this point of time. The figures, as in the newspaper today, it must have crossed 117 million. That would have been the situation.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. The permission has been given to share your screen, sir. You can do that.
It's still showing that host disabled participant screen sharing. When I try to share, it's still saying that message.
I'll just check again, sir.
So at this point of time, when we are talking about the world situation, India is far, far better situation compared to the density of population. And the kind of health infrastructure we have, we could not have coped with present infrastructure if this lockdown might not have come at the right time. I remember then first case of this in December, it was reported from Wuhan city. And on 7th and 8th January, we had a homeopathic prophylaxis conference in Delhi. It was an international conference in Delhi, which we organized on 7th and 8th January. And I think at that point of my time, in my speech during the inauguration of that particular homeopathic prophylaxis conference, I did mention about this upcoming pandemic. at that point of time, on 7th and 8th of January, when even WHO was not even sent its warning to the countries. Because in the media, in electronic media, we could see that some pneumonia cases with unknown etiology was reporting more in Wuhan city. And even on, I think the coronavirus was linked, this novel coronavirus are linked only on 7th or 8th of January only. They could detect that virus, that it's a new kind of a coronavirus. And since then, our epidemic cell has been working. What could be the future of this kind of an epidemic? In our epidemic cell, we started working on that. And when Ministry of Ayush asked us to come out with some kind of advisory, what we have to offer from homeopathic side, it was somewhere in February when our scientific advisory board meeting was going on. We received a message from Ministry of Ayush that we have to, by evening, we have to tell them, is there any measure from homeopathic side which we can suggest for arresting the spread of this particular epidemic? Because before that, it has already knocked the doors of India, the first case which was reported in Kerala. So, because of the high death rate in age population in China and being reported from other parts of the world, our scientific advisory board discussed the symptomatology at that point of time, which was available with us, which was only published in Lancet journal. The symptomatology was reported from Wuhan city. There was a detailed symptom account which was published in Lancet journal. So we took note of those symptomatology at that point of time. And some of our colleagues in Hong Kong, homeopathic fraternity, who also participated in homeoprophylaxis conference, Dr. R.M. Toh, we also contacted him at that point in time, that because at that time he was also treating some of the cases in Hong Kong with homeopathic medicines. So we also requested him, can you inform us what is the symptomatology as per homeopathic point of view? He did share some of the cases with some of the symptomatology which was received by us at that time. So we analyzed this information and we could come to a conclusion by the scientific advisory board members that arsenic album is the possible genus epidemicus at that point of time, because in India at that time only few cases reported and we never had an access to COVID positive patient at that point of time. So we analyzed this information which was available from other sources, and we had articles available with us from other part of the world, and we had information with us on ILI studies which we have taken up before this, and we could find out that arsenic was still covering most of the cases of ILI in our study, and it was also found to be a kind of a prophylactic medicine called ILI, which we were distributing in Rajasthan and other areas. So finally, this was the decision that arsenic album 30 can be recommended. It has a immunity enhancement evidence available with us that it increases the cellular immunity. Interferon gamma and then NF kappa B, it has raised in some of the trials. So this was suggested to the Ministry of Ayush at that point of time. So we discussed with this, and now I will be just making a presentation on these aspects of, if you can see, I think everyone is seeing the screen on your side. Dr. Venkatesh, can you confirm? Is it visible? My presentation is visible?
Yes, doctor, it's quite
very
visible.
Very much, sir. Thank you.
Oh, okay. So if you can see that COVID-19, it started reporting from Hubei province of, and there's a Wuhan city in that Hubei province, which was affected at that time. Because they started reporting cluster of pneumonia cases of unknown origin in December 2019, and these cluster of pneumonia cases were of unknown origin. And now we can see that out of 41 patients at that point of time, 66% had exposure to a seafood market, and this, so that is a zoonotic virus which has jumped from snakes and bats to the human beings. It has become pathogenic to human beings at that point of time. The first case, which was reported on 12th December 2019, on 31st December, Chinese authorities alerted WHO about cases of pneumonia of unknown etiology. Then on 1st January, Wuhan seafood market was closed. On 3rd January, India notified by WHO. On 7 January 2019, this novel coronavirus was identified when we were having this, our Homo prophylaxis conference in Delhi. On 12th January, Wuhan's first death was reported. And on 30 January, Thailand confirms their first case outside China. India also received one positive case on 30th January, which was reported in and these are the cases which actually came from China only, who traveled from China to Kerala part. On 11 February, virus was renamed as SARS coronavirus 2, and disease was named as COVID-19. On 28th February, if you can see WHO, they declared that it's a regional global risk. So it was very high. On 3rd March, cases 74 countries, there was local transmission was reported. So this is the current status as of today. Almost 38 million people are now affected at this point of time. If you can see, these are the figures in the countries. Almost 265,000, almost 266,000 deaths have been reported to WHO till now. If you can see this graph, the epidemic curve of confirmed COVID-19 by date of report and WHO region. See, if you can see that least affected is till now is African side, but most of the affected side is Europe and America. These are the continents which have affected the most. Now it is because of our earlier lockdown situation and also some special measure taken by Southeast Asia countries. The figures are a little on lower side. This is the state of India. Almost half country is now badly affected. Mostly affected is this Maharashtra, and followed by that Gujarat, and then Tamil Nadu, and now other area, even Delhi is now worst affected at this point of time. But there are certain areas which are still green zones in India. Yesterday only 2,951 cases have been confirmed, reported as positive. So the graph is now going up, although there was slight decrease in mortality rate somewhere, but the recovery rate is coming closer to now 30%. Now we know about this coronavirus. It is positive strand RNA virus, is enveloped with a fat molecules, ecologically diverse. It circulates in humans and animals, divided into four genera: alpha, beta, delta, and gamma. Only alpha and beta, which are infecting humans, and there are four endemic globally, kind of a viruses, then 10 to 30% of upper respiratory tract infections which are causing in adults. Rarely animal coronaviruses evolve and infect people and then spread between people. SARS was the last reported in 2002, and then MERS, Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, in 2012, and now this is COVID-19. This coronavirus has a transmissibility. Although there are many variations coming into, mostly it is droplet infection. If it is more than 5 micrometer diameter, it can travel even less than 1 meter. So there has been a safe distance limit of 6 feet has been advised. So social distancing can prevent infection from one person to another. This virus outside the body can survive up to 1 to 2 days on non-porous surfaces and 8 to 12 hours on porous surface. Currently, this information is still not clear. It has an incubation period of 2 to 14 days on average, but it has been reported that cases, even some of the cases are reported even on 21st day post-infection. This is the data about the life of this virus, like in aerosols. You can see number of hours, 3 hours. Copper, it can stay up to maximum up to 8 hours. Cardboard, it can doesn't stay more than 24 hours. And stainless steel, it has 24 hours and even up to 96 hours. And maximum stays there in on plastic, where it can stay even more than 76 hours. Now, age distribution, which was in China reported earlier, now these figures from countrywide, this was earlier data. The median age is 51 years, as a mostly from 39 to 63 years, mostly affected. 2 days to 100 years, children of 2 days and age as high as even 100 years are also reported infection with COVID. Males are affected more by 51%, and healthcare workers are getting affected as 3.8%. And we can see that no foreign travel, this is the definition, even no foreign travel, contact with known laboratory confirmed number of cases which are 40%, 39.2%, contact with a known laboratory confirmed COVID-19 case, there are 2% of cases. This was a small data which was reported earlier in a small sample of 102 in China study. But when we see that only 4 to 5% are going to the critical stage, but at this point of time, mild or even asymptomatic cases constitute the largest chunk, that is 81%. So many people are still reporting asymptomatic and with mild presentation. But some of them are going to severe stage of 14% and even to the critical stage. The case fatality increases with the increasing age. And we can see with this graph that the fatality rate goes more than almost 14% if they are aged more than 80. So this is how we have to take care of the elders. They should not get affected. A chart of signs and symptoms of cases which were reported in China at that point of time, which was reported in Lancet Journal also. Maximum people presented with dry cough, fever and sore throat at early and shortness of breath, actually, distress in breathing. But few other presentations were also there, someone even reported with diarrhea also. Now people are reporting with diarrhea, nasal congestion, even anosmia, altered state, taste and smell, headache, skin, nausea, vomiting, even myalgias. All these are common symptoms we can see from the infection which are of viral origin. The severity of illness, you can see that with the comorbidities, the presentation is very severe, and there is no comorbidity, less number of people are going to severity stage. Fever usually reports in the initial days. They may persist up to 12 days. And if you can see there, the survivors and non-survivors, you can see that they have continued even up to 13th day or 14th day. This is the data of survivors and non-survivors. And we can see that most of the cases, they start early dyspnea by 6th or 7th day, and they can continue. There is chance of having secondary infection at 17th, and death is reported by 19th day also. So these are different kind of information about days from illness onset and the D-dimer values which are being reported, and cytokines which we can see at that point of time. Even serum ferritin levels, how it is going high and low according to the progress of the disease. Now, why we are asking for this social distancing, that the average, the scientist measure intensity of infection, this is based on reproduction number. If one person is able to infect other 2.5 people, even if they maintain a social distance. So if one person can infect even 0.6 people infected, and they maintain a social distance, and this reduces if we social exposure by 75% if we maintain this kind of a social distancing. But if we do not maintain this social distancing, more and more people get infected. And if there would have not been a lockdown situation, each person is going to be infecting almost 406 people in the next 30 days. So with this basic information about general aspects of COVID-19, we can conclude that COVID-19 is a respiratory pathogen. It is easily transmissible from person to person. Elderly and comorbid are at high risk. It is a pandemic with global public health consequences. You know what is the situation of economic consequences going on throughout the world now because of this pandemic. Containment and mitigation is the prime management at this point of time. So there is a clear-cut case identification and management. There's a mechanism to go for a contract tracing. Then they are isolated or sent to quarantine zones. A large-scale social distancing at a periodic intervals, that's a lockdown, or continuing to flatten the curve. Health system strengthening, that has helped in to containment and mitigation. When we, because of this lockdown, the government is now prepared to face situation of if this number goes high. So infrastructure ready at this point of time. So now coming to the homeopathy and epidemics part. We all know that there is a strong preventive role of homeopathy in epidemic diseases. And we have many epidemics starting from the very cholera and Hahnemann's time. Many advised medicines at that point of time, Spanish flu, yellow fever, scarlet fever, diphtheria, typhoid. CCRH has also taken up many studies, which I'm talking right now. And we know about this Spanish flu pandemic 1918 and 1919. We have an access to many such literature, which we have dig out from the archives. And now a lot of information is now available with us on that Spanish flu, which affected 20 million people died worldwide at that point in time. And more than 5 lakh people died in the United States alone at that. But when we see that the data of homeopathy, which was reported by Julian Winston, historian, the death rate for patients who were treated with homeopathy, the death rate was only 1 to 2% compared to with a 30 to 60% mortality for those treated by conventional physicians. We know this success story in Andhra Pradesh, where I'm talking now to my colleagues in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. We know that this BCT is a success story, which has now shown us this graph here that the JEE incidence has gone down almost nil in last up to 2004. It became nil because of this BCT prophylaxis, homeopathic prophylaxis, which was taken up by the state government. And this is the effectiveness of Equatorium prophylactum as preventive in dengue. And I can see that, tell you that we have been taking up this study in our some of the JJ clusters in New Delhi, where they are most vulnerable to mosquito bites getting affected with this dengue. And if you can see that in medicine group who received this Equatorium prophylactum, the only 2% total fever incidence was only 5.3% as compared to 34.4%. Although during this period, dengue was not reported high in the population. Even then, we can see the incidence of fever was almost 20% less as compared to 30% less as compared to the controlled population. Even chikungunya, which is reported high during those days, the infection reported was only 5.8% as compared to 27.5% in the controlled population. This is the graphical representation of the same incidence of fever in medicine group, which was 5% and 34% in control group. And then when we had a study on influenza-like illness, and we could also report at that point in time that the infection rate, the reporting of ILI kind of a cases was much, much less in homeopathic group as compared to the control population. This is how the data reported at that time, that the if we go by only fever cases, it was only 0.8% as compared to 1.34% in a control group. And if we go by the definition of ILI, you can see that fever plus cough, it was 5.79% in medicine group where influenza was given at that time. And it was 18.18% in the control population. In fact, the fever incidence was almost very low. If you can see the blue line here, the dots, the medicine group that is influenza, it could show that the incidence of fever was very low throughout the 14 weeks period. Even this study of genus epidemicus Brynia alba was also taken up in southern part in Kerala, where they could report that Brynia alba was as a prophylactic, which was genus epidemicus identified at the time. And in the homeopathic group, there was a significant reduction in the incidence of this chikungunya incidence. So we can see that there was substantial protection in homeopathic group by Brynia alba. There was almost 20% relative risk reduction which was observed by Brynia. Now we also did an adjuvant kind of a treatment for dengue in one of the allopathic hospital in Delhi, where we added homeopathic treatment to the management of thrombocytopenia due to dengue. And you can see here the data here. If you can see this data here, the platelet count in homeopathic group along with the usual care which is given into the hospital, the jump in platelet count was more than double. If you can see the day one, there was only 7,000 jump in platelet count as compared to 19,000 in homeopathic group, which was almost more than double. Similarly, you can see on day two, there was further increase of 41,000 up to average of mean platelet count jump, that was 41,000 as compared to 17,000 in usual care. And on day three, most of the patients beyond 50,000, they were discharged and there were availability of beds for the next patient. So we can see that just adding simple homeopathic medicine to the usual care, the stay in hospital was reduced by more than 2 days, and even the requirement of platelet concentrate was much, much less as compared to usual care. Another study which we took up on acute encephalitis syndrome in children. This is a endemic disease in Gorakhpur area. And we had this study with in BRD Medical College, Gorakhpur, where we added homeopathic medicine to their institutional management protocol, where they give symptomatic treatment for fever, epileptic fits. And we can see that at that, even in that point of time, when these children who just land up to the hospital in disoriented stage with high fever, convulsions, and some even in disoriented stage and then even in coma. So when we added this homeopathic medicine to the treatment protocol, if you can see in this table, in a homeopathic group which was added to the trainer, almost even sample size was quite good, almost 300 in both the arms. You can see the death rate was 13% in homeopathic group as compared to placebo means, where only usual care was given, it was 28%. So there was 15% reduction in mortality in children. So we could prevent a good number of children which were going to die just with adding simple homeopathic indicated medicine. Even the sequelae, if you can see here, there was good recovery in 80% cases as compared to only 50% cases in placebo group. So there was less sequelae even in homeopathic group as compared to the usual care. So these are some of the examples where we can see that this add-on, even we can suggest, even we have also suggested government allow us to take up trials for adjuvant homeopathy. Now you will all be asking me what we have done till now. As a CCRH, being a research organization, the first thing which I mentioned in the introduction, we had issued an advisory through the Ministry of Ayush suggesting arsenic album 30 as prophylactic and for immunity boosting. And thanks to all the state governments and to the Ministry of Ayush, because of this advisory, this arsenic album 30 has been widely distributed by many state governments to their own infrastructure and logistics available to them. Even most of the colleges have distributed, our CCR research centers have also distributed this prophylactic medicine. And because of this, now we have started receiving good stories, small stories, although we are collecting data on a scientific platform in a structured formats, but some small stories which we are now receiving from different quarters, where they have mentioned that arsenic album 30 has protected many people not getting affected this. Although these are only small examples, but we need a big data to support our claim. The fact sheet uploaded on website of CCRH for practitioners, which we did on our website. Anybody can go and see the details of the situation which is surrounding this COVID-19 and the facts and figures about this COVID-19 and what we advise at that point of time. We, as per the mandate of Ministry of Ayush, there was a proposal to train our homeopathic practitioners on all aspects of COVID-19. And this was taken up through CCR researchers and who was actually trained as a master trainers and some of the many faculties in all the homeopathic medical colleges. They further trained their subordinate as colleagues and then in the faculties and other homeopathic practitioners. Some of you might have attended these training programs, webinars through online small trainings. And these have also been taken by central and state level government setups. Almost thousands of homeopathic practitioners have, at this point of time, has taken up this training, and I'm happy to inform you that we did a small knowledge, attitude and practice survey through Google form, which was circulated on social media. And almost more than 4,000 homeopathic practitioners participated into that knowledge, attitude, practice format, and they submitted their information. And it was quite encouraging to note that our homeopathic practitioners, and we have analyzed that data also, is going to come out as an article in our upcoming issue of IJRH. We observed 85% literacy about COVID-19 in our homeopathic practitioners. So it's a very good sign that our homeopathic practitioners have updated themselves about COVID-19, and they were knowing a lot of about this, although there was small issues about some confusion on social distancing, quarantine and isolation. These were some of the questions they could differentiate properly. That's why there was 50-50 response. Otherwise, in most of the questions they answered very well, and there was 85% literacy we observed. And the Government of India also advised for self-learning from iGOT Diksha. I think everybody must go into this. They should visit this iGOT Diksha program of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. There are certain modules available on that. Please go through those modules, listen to them. That will update your knowledge. You will be feel confident while dealing with these COVID-19 patients. We also did a webinar on World Homeopathy Day 2019 fall in between on 10th April. Since we could not meet physically in a conference, big conference that we used to organize every year, this time we organized a webinar, and I am happy to inform you that almost around 2,000 actually participated at that webinar, and almost 7,000 joined on Facebook Live. And coming to the last slide, these are some of the protocols which we have developed. This is like a protocol which is using homeopathic intervention, people which are under quarantine, means who have already under observation because they have come into touch with a COVID-19 person. The main objective is to prevent the person going to symptomatic stage and do not turn positive for coronavirus. So that is the main aim, and that's why these kind of protocols are ready, which have been approved by our Council's Scientific Virology Board and Institutional Ethics, our Central Ethics Committee. And we have shared this protocol to some of the colleges who were willing to take up such a study. And at two centers, this quarantine study has been already been started. For COVID positive persons who are asymptomatic, actually, means who are positive, but they, I told you earlier that many patients are still reporting asymptomatic, although they are COVID positive. So here the aim is to get them sero negative, or even if symptoms develop, they are mild and they may recover fast if they are given medicine. So we are yet to start with this trial and some of the center, because we are trying to get approval from COVID treatment center to give us a permission to take up such a trial. These protocols are ready with us. And third one is, as I discussed in my previous slides, that for patients who are COVID positive and symptomatic and are admitted into the hospitals suffering from mild to moderate illnesses, we can add on homeopathic treatment to the standard care to see that if they can prevent complications, there is a faster recovery and they can be discharged early. And with the support of CCRH, at two places, these trials have already begun. And third stage, a pilot, few cases treatment has been taken up by one of the physician. So these are some of the developments which I wanted to share with you all. And I see a good scope of homeopathy here in this particular pandemic, if Government of India various places at COVID treatment centers, we get faster approvals for treating and these cases, even in research mode manner, we can come out with positive results. Another study which we are going to now take up is on containment areas like quarantine, people who are living in a sealed area where they are likely to get infected. And so we are going to start that particular study at a mass level study involving 10 research centers, consistent research centers, and a very big sample size, which we have planned to undertake with the approval of Ministry of Ayush. And you all know that we request you all, there's a mobile app has been now developed by Ministry of Ayush. The link is available on social media. This is called Sanjeevani, Arogya Sanjeevani. You can all download that app on your mobile. Everybody who has taken some kind of a prophylaxis, any Ayush prophylaxis, then they should upload their personal information on that, so that data of 50 lakh people, which is targeted through this mobile app to be captured by Ministry of Ayush, that will be analyzed later on. So there's a need to propagate this particular mobile app by each and every physician to their patients, to the person, to their friends, their family members, wherever they have advised to take up homeopathic medicine as a prophylaxis. Everyone should propagate this mobile app so that it reaches to masses, so that they can upload their personal information, and that will build up big data on this kind of. Thank you all for patient listening to me. And I hope we will be succeeding in our endeavors, which we intend to take up. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Khurana sir, for the nice presentation, for giving us an idea about what is going on, sir. And there have been some queries, observations, and feelings of homeopathic physicians over a period of this past 4 weeks, sir. Like, sir, for example, from the state of Telangana, from February 6th onwards, under the direction of Department of Ayush, a preventive medicine of arsenic L30 was being given to all international travelers who were coming into the country through Hyderabad. And till March 18th, it was taken up. And we have seen that the number of people who got infected actually after taking the preventive is significantly less. For example, if you compare other states to state of Telangana, today also the total positive cases are not more than 1200, and most of them are after the second incident from Delhi, where they got contracted with this virus, sir. And according to the Chief Minister of Telangana, there was not even one person who died of COVID-19 of those who were infected who have come from abroad. And there has not been any lateral spread also, sir. So our request was, sir, we require your advice regarding this, sir, whether epidemiological study and a biostatic study can be done by the department here, sir, so that it can make a valid research paper and add more quality to it, sir.
Why not? I think the state authorities, if they go ahead for this kind of a study, there's a large number of people who, even if they can just capture the information of people who have COVID positive, whether they had taken homeopathic preventive before or not. So that will make an assessment if they have not taken a homeopathic prophylaxis, and how many people who have taken homeopathic prophylaxis still they got infected. That difference will show some kind of evidence in favor of homeopathy. Yes. But there is a large number of population which is there in generally, and this is actually season for ILI also at some of the states. So we have to capture information even on symptomatic basis. Even if there's no testing done at the field level, still by the clinical definition we can capture information how many people who got arsenic album 30 as a prophylaxis. did they suffer from that kind of a symptoms which are likely to indicate towards this kind of illness? So this is how we can collect information on a structured format. But this, even this Sanjeevani app, everybody can go ahead with that kind of a data. If they upload that data on that Sanjeevani app, there will be an indirect kind of a data which will be coming up, evidence which will be coming up to us, that most of the people, how many of them have actually received this medicine and what kind of suffering they had later on after that.
Sir, as a matter of fact, sir, the Commissioner of Ayush State of Telangana has all the data of the people who have taken the preventive medicine, sir. And probably if a small project can be taken up to call them up and find out how many have really got infected, at least we have the data now, sir.
So this study can be taken up by the colleges.
Gauri.
Sir.
Gauri, can I say something?
Yeah, please go ahead first.
The thing is that what happened, the medicinal distribution in the airport. So they distributed something like 6,000 people. That is, includes foreigner travels and airport people who are working in the airport. And there are certain passengers and people who are attending on airport. So we have a data of 6,000 people with us. And I did a small exercise on that. I called upon something like 200 people.
Okay, sir.
What they had after taking that medicine. So out of that, 70% of people said that no complaints or no symptoms after taking that arsenic. And we could not contact 10% of people where phone numbers are not there with them. So,
okay,
so we are doing some exercise on that. It takes some time to come out what you call concretely what is the effect of that.
Okay.
I just wanted to clarify here that whenever we are trying to assess the prophylactic effect of a medicine,
okay,
we need to have an appropriate sample, and that appropriate sample can be drawn only if we know what is the infection rate in the population. So in case of COVID-19, we don't have that kind of a epidemiological data even available still now in the public domain. This is the data which has been reported is only for people who have come into contact with a COVID positive person. Still, the government of India has not declared it as a community transmission. So there is no infection rate available at this point of time. ICMR has just started 2 days back the community transmission trial, which they are going to take up all cases who are reported with severe acute respiratory distress, the SARI. And they will be now testing them and to assess whether anybody has come into a contact with a COVID positive person. Even if they have not come into contact with a COVID-19 person, it means there is a chance that they have got contracted this infection from the community. So how much this community transmission rate is available at this point of time, we don't know. So at this point of time, we are not going to make any kind of a claim that our medicine has protected. That can only be done with a proper sampling, with a big study which we have to take up further, unless we get this kind of an infection rate available to us. So at this point of time, because of lockdown's special situation, people are inside homes, actual infection is not known at this point of time. So that is a major hurdle in taking up a proper scientific study to come out with it, and without going into testing of those people who became symptom, whether they have got virus positive in their blood or not, or antibodies. Still now, no antibody testing kit is in the market. There were some kits came out from China, but they were rejected because of some false positivity report. So that has not been taken up. But there are certain other kits which have been developed in-house in the country, but their specificity, sensitivity is still not very high, not known in appropriate manner. So that is why at this point of time, unless we have a proper scientific study, only then we should start claiming that, yes, I could prevent this much of infection in the community. But big data, lakhs of data will just give some indication Yes, there is a less number of infection. Yes, if there is a, if we could take up a study, only those families where COVID positive person was reporting. If we could have a data whether any of them has nursing and still not got infected. So that is kind of a data we can build up from these kind of a patients, their family members. Then we can have some kind of evidence. Yes, other people who did not take arsenic, they got infected. Gave you an example of one of doctors from Karnataka. He gave medicine to a girl, which is there in UK, and these six girls were actually sharing their room in UK. But one who were known to this doctor. She took arsenic alone by herself. And strangely, other five, their roommates, they got infected with this COVID positive. They become COVID positive. But this girl remained negative at this point of time.
Thank you, sir. And the second thing was, sir, like we had written under the advice of our president, Dr. Sampath Rao, to the Institute for Clinical Research, ICMR, and also our body, sir, requesting to make a NoSode at the earliest, sir, because as we know, NoSode can be both be a very ideal preventive and also a good curative, no, sir. So we need your good offices to hasten up the process, sir.
Now you are rightly pointed out, this is a good question about Corona NoSode, because I did not put in a slide there for this Corona NoSode. The reason being that we take actually NoSode in a very simpler way. It's not like that. It's a biological virus which has a high infectivity. So we have to go for a safety trial before taking up a human trial. Preparing a NoSode is very simple. Just kill the virus and dilute it. But it's not that simple. You have to see whether it is not able to infect even in dilutions. Because in one of the trials which we took up with a dengue virus NoSode, we found that it was not found to be safe even in 200 potency, up to 200 potency. It was able to generate a lot of kind of a adverse immunological response. Now we still want to actually verify that data which is available for dengue NoSode. So we have to be very cautious about going through NoSode. There are 3-4 proposals which are in the ministry for getting approval for the Corona NoSode, but we have to give them a safety data. Safety data means it has to be on animal models, it should be tried to find out its safety. It doesn't have any immunogenicity. It's not going to infect others. That's kind of thing which we need to do. So it is a little long drawn process for bringing this NoSode to the market.
Sir, one last thing from our association, sir. Our president had requested you, sir, even in February when the virus was going on strong in China, in Wuhan, to actually impress on our government to speak to China and even distribute preventive medicine in that country. Probably we could have had a study and we could have a better idea about how our preventive was working, sir. And later on, we also understand, sir, that homeopathy has not been given its due. What does the government need more, sir? Because from your side, you have presented all the evidence-based research to the government, sir. But what is that they want more, sir?
I think the government has taken a proactive role in giving us the permission to take up research trials. So that notification has been issued by the ministry on 10th April. Now we can take up these research trials, which was earlier we were not allowed to even touch even COVID positive person. So now I told you that two trials have already been started as adjuvant homeopathy, and two in quarantine centers. Now we are going to start trial on contained areas. So these permissions have been received, and government in the very beginning issued this advisory of arsenic album. That's why the states could take up this arsenic. I think no other medicine has been distributed so widely throughout the country as arsenic album has been given to many by many states. So government has, Ministry of Ayush has taken all kind of a proactive roles. It was only access to those patients which came late, even in the mid of this, and we had, by that time we were ready with our protocols and those approvals of CTRA registration, ethical committee approvals. Since these things take some small time, that's why we could start by the first week of this May, we could start these trials.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. This moment, I request Dr. Sampath Rao Garu to say a few words before we pass on the baton to the second speaker, Dr. Anand Kulkarni.
Thank you, Dr. Kunana, sir, for your wonderful information you shared with our participants. Now, I request Dr. Anand Kulkarni to start his presentation. Dr. Venu, please welcome him and please unmute everybody when the speakers are speaking. During the question answer session only, sorry, you mute everybody. During the question answer session, please unmute everybody. Dr. Venu.
Yes, thank you, sir. We have another dynamic speaker, Dr. Anand Kulkarni, arguably one of the intelligent and research-oriented and academically oriented personality of all homeopathic colleges in the country. We are also happy to inform you that his college, under his guidance and of course the guidance of seniors like Dr. Ashok Patil sir and Dr. Sampath Rao sir, they have got a permission to do clinical trials in COVID-19, and we want him to enlighten us.
Good evening, sirs. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Venugopal Gauri, sir. And I'm really grateful that I'm talking to such an august gathering here. At the outset, let me use half a minute to say that I am not someone of anywhere near caliber to Dr. Kurana, sir. Kurana, sir, is a client there. And nowhere nearby to him also. The reason why I'm asked to speak today also is something a mystery to me. But yet, since this matter is upon... Since this mantle is upon me, let me make some attempts to justify. Well, I have divided my small talk in some four rubrics. Rubric number one, side heading number one is that research. Now, research is something that we all do every day in our practice. We practice all through our life. Nobody is a master. The practice that we do is nothing but the research. But it lacks a specific format. The problem with our practice is that it lacks a specific format, because the same format can be exchanged and people understand what we have done and what somebody has done and what somebody else can do. The problem with our research has been applicability of a format. Well, applicability of a format for all kinds of researchers, the basic minimum requirement of knowledge, what kind of research, the design, etc., has been somewhere inculcated in our undergraduate studies. When we studied community medicine as part of our undergraduate studies. And now, at least, since this COVID outbreak has happened, you know, nowadays we are talking of all kinds of studies, all kinds of data. We are all, you know...
Sorry to interrupt you, Dr. Kulkarni. Yes. There's some noise from your side, sir. Can you please? Because all the other mics are muted.
Sir, am I audible, sir?
There was some disturbance.
Am I audible, fine, sir?
Yeah, you are audible. Yeah, there was some disturbance in the background. Sorry.
Some in the disturbance, like the air, wind is coming. Please take care.
Yeah, I had you are audible. Able fan, sir. Probably that was what was troubling you.
Yeah, oscillation fan.
Sorry, my apologies. Well, the point that I was trying to make is that the research format is what that is the need of our. Dr. Khurana sir was making a very valid point while talking about the research format and the research format which Central Council for Research in Homeopathy has come up with. Right. CCRH has definitely come out with a research format for COVID-19. Then, if you go to the ministry's website, hello. Yeah, can I continue, sir?
Yeah, you continue.
If you go through the ministry's website, the ministry has advertised for an expedited extramural research scheme. You know, many of us know about extramural researches. Now, there is an expedited extramural research, which is a very express kind of producing a research proposal and getting it sanctioned. Well, before I go on that, I would like to deliberate on some small experience that I have about this epidemic and why this kind of research project or a format is needed. I hope everybody remembers that in 2016, if I am right, we had this chikungunya epidemic. And during those days, all of us, many of us, in fact, had brought out some genus epidemics, and then we reached out to common men. And through my institution, I went and distributed to some 4,10,000 individuals. I recorded the data, said that this person was given on this day. And out of 4,10,000 people, only 19 people reported back saying that they got chikungunya despite getting the prophylactic. Now, this data, 4,10,000, is not a small data. But what it lacked was there was no plan how it was given, why it was given, when it was given, when we need to get back, what kind of response, and how to tabulate it, how to produce it in statistical manner. Why? Because anybody else understands figures. They don't understand the process. Nobody is much greatly interested in process. They are interested in the end figures. So that entire effort of such big number went to waste. It is totally a waste. So as practitioners like you and me, we can definitely make an effort to produce this data in the way it can be discussed and disseminated. So that's the reason why hats off to CCRH. They have come up with this format. Please go on the CCRH website. You will find this format available to us. Well, insofar as research is concerned, particularly COVID-19 research, which I was mentioning earlier, the Government of India has come up with the expedited extramural research. Last date was 1st of May, and I spoke to the the Undersecretary concerned, and they have extended till 15th of this month. Anyone who is an audience here can produce one proposal and can be submitted. It is not a big deal. The only requirement is that you need to have a clearance from an institutional ethics committee as well as it has to be registered on Clinical Trial Research Institute of ICMR. Both of them are not great thing. All that it requires is some 2-3 days concentrated work. I bet with anyone that this is really possible. The proposals, we submitted 3 proposals to ministry, as well as yesterday night I have registered even on CTRI, one among them, and if Khurana sir is still there, tomorrow morning I am supposed to speak to him to get clearance for this. It is not a big thing. Why I am saying that it is not a big thing is that we have somewhere small kind of fear that the moment we use the word research, we want somebody else to do the research. Somebody has to come up with research. And in this regard, someone is trying to share screen. Is there anything specific, sir? I wanted to...
Shared by Dr. Durga Prasad Rao.
Yes, sir,
shared.
Please.
Dr. Durga Prasad Rao, can you stop sharing the screen, please?
Can be submitted by anyone. It can be an individual, it can be a group of individuals, it can be an institution, it can be a research council or whomsoever. There is no bar, let me repeat, no bar that it requires some institution. You can do it on your own, number one. Number two is regarding availability of patients. Since this is a notified disease, as of now, you are not allowed to treat on your own. You require to have either your own facility or you need to have a tie-up with a facility where COVID-19 patients are available. I'll present to you 2 different scenarios where people have taken up research of this kind. Number one is at Agra, the Neminath Homeopathic Medical College. They are having a quarantine center where patients or people who have come in contact with COVID-19 patients are quarantined. There, COVID positive patients are not there. They will not be there because that's a quarantine center. Whereas there is another type of facility that is created by government that is called COVID care center. These are places where COVID positive patients are admitted having either being asymptomatic or having very mild COVID symptoms, very mild symptoms like influenza-like illness, like some small cough, cold or something like that, what Dr. Khurana sir was telling us. Fine. Then we have another set of hospitals called as COVID-designated hospitals where the severe acute respiratory illness patients are admitted. So, there are 2 models that we have. The Agra model is where Dr. Pradeep Kumar Gupta has taken a project and he is allowed to work in a nearby medical college, which is a designated COVID care center and COVID-designated hospital. And there, the protocol is pre-decided and he will be running the entire research project as an adjuvant therapy. Already the fixed therapy is going on, allopathic therapy is going on, and there is an adjuvant therapy which can be added. This is what is going on. Dr. Khurana sir was mentioning this. 2 such projects are going on right now, and for homeopathy, and 5 for Ayurveda are going on. 5 for Ayurveda are going on, for 2 for homeopathy are going on right now. Whereas the second kind of example that we have is what I am going through. We have a COVID care center. COVID care center is a place, as I told earlier, where COVID positive, asymptomatic or mildly symptomatic patients are there who does not require some acute emergency kind of treatment or such kind of equipment and personnel is needed. So here
the kind of intervention that we can bring in from homeopathic side is quite big. The reason is that we know for sure that nobody is ending up into some emergency. Fine. So for that reason, this is a better place to work. Any researcher, any practitioner who would like to get associated, what all he or she has to do is please go through the format that is there on ministry's website under EMR. If you wish, I will put it on the WhatsApp group. Anyone can take print of it. Anyone can modify it. It is not a routine extramural research where many, many formalities are asked. Here, the formalities are very rudimentary. It has to go through, this research proposal has to go through a clearance of institutional ethics committee. Since mine is an institution, we have institutional ethics. Dr. Sampatra, sir, is it true? It's a requirement. Institutional ethics committee has to be of a certain character, certain type. There are definite guidelines what constitutes an institutional ethics committee. So it has to go through that, and then it has to be registered on CTRI, Clinical Trial Research Institute of ICMR. All clinical trials in this country are mandatory to be registered on CTRI. And CTRI clearance also comes very easily. It's not something very great. All that you need to do is there is a format. The format has to be followed. And to follow the format, there is minimum requirement of biostatistician or a research pathologist. Why? Because it has all been now simplified due to this emergency situation. We are under COVID-19 now. All these protocols have been made very user-friendly. In fact, one among the audience here is one of my colleagues. He prepared a research project flat in 4 hours. It took hardly 4 hours for him to prepare. So if he took 4 hours, a young man like him took 4 hours, anyone who is very experienced here will take hardly half an hour or 1 hour. So I don't have any lot of doubts over it. If there is no institutional ethics committee, if you don't have one, then also there is no problem. There are 2-3 avenues that you have. Since you are a practitioner or someone who is not in institution, any institution where COVID patients are admitted, that institution will be having institutional ethics committee. Please submit it in front of that. There can be an emergency meeting of it, like how we are having meeting right now. Emergency meeting of it, institutional ethics committee will give, and then CTRI will give in no time. It hardly takes 2 days. So the routine process and procedure is cut short for COVID-19. The point that I would like to highlight is that all that we require is to make up our mind rather than anything else. There are some challenges. This is the third rubric under which I would like to speak. There are some challenges that we have. Challenge number one is the local authorities. The local authorities, like your substitutional magistrate, the district magistrate, and the state disaster management authority. These are the people with whom you will come in contact. All these people are under NDMA right now. NDMA Act is promulgated under in all the states right now. And under NDMA, the standard ICMR guided and mandated protocol for treating any COVID patient has to be followed. There cannot be any let up. Fine. So presently, homeopathy or Ayurveda are being allowed as adjuvant therapies presently. But as the number of such applications are going very high right now, there are around, I am told by the undersecretary to whom I spoke on the other day, there are 28 applications right now with the ministry. So as the numbers are increasing, they are even thinking of making it a first line treatment. They are thinking. They have brought this matter to appropriate authorities and they are thinking. So why not to start as an adjuvant therapy? So this is this problem starts with the local subdivisional magistrate, who is the one who gives you this first clearance to even go near a COVID positive patient who is known COVID positive patient. He is the first authority who will give. So he has to be made understood about this EMR. He has to be made understood about the advisory of Ministry of Ayush and your antecedents. Number two is at national level, we have wonderful apparatus. Dr. Khurana sir is there to help us out as well. We have these bodies, that is CTRI. Very heartful to tell everyone that they are working 24 hours. Somebody calls me at 11:30. I told you sometime back that I registered it yesterday night. He calls me at 11:30 in the night and asks me, I'm not finding that application. Would you mind uploading once more? Look at the kind of emergent situation they are working in. Well, the next point that I'd like to make is that COVID-19 patients as everyone knows, are people suffering from nothing more than a flu. So when people are suffering from flu, what all precautions that we take while treating anyone with flu, this flu is more infective. Such precautions have to be taken. To get trained in those precautions, I would like to suggest that please go to Ministry of Ayush's website, where you will get the training modules. There are three training modules. Please undergo institution-wise, it was mandated to us. That's the reason why all of us are trained in that. But individually also, these are some simple basic learning modules. Anyone can undergo that. It is not required that somebody has to come and teach. They are so self-explanatory. So I request all the distinguished audience here to please undergo these training modules. Lastly, I would like to share my experience insofar as getting these approvals done. Sorry and very sadly to tell everyone that nobody forthcomes with any approval. The kind of red tapeism, the kind of, second class citizen kind of attitude that we have is prevailing everywhere. What all is required is a persistent lobbying there, telling about the Ayush advisory. So Ayush advisory is all encompassing and it is something that works wonder, provided somebody is committed to the cause. I have not told everything in a nutshell. If anything more somebody would like to know, I'd be very happy to tell whatever I know.
Thank you, Dr. Kulkarni. There were some things what are the investigations that are being done on the patients and...
I somewhere in the flow, in this technological glitches, I missed that point. Sir, the best part of COVID-19, the worst part is people are suffering and dying, that's a thing. But the best part of it is all the investigations, the moment you are having a patient who has got ILI or a contact with any COVID positive patient, are done by government. It is free of cost. That's the reason why I was saying that whether you want a funding or you don't want a funding. Funding is basically needed for carrying out these investigations. All these investigations are made free. Government of India has made it as part of the research project. If at all you are taking funding from Government of India, the funding is up to 10 lakhs, sir. So if you are doing that, all these investigations are made free from Government of India, whatever is the name of it. For example, I am told that in the Agra experiment which is going on, they have taken up 9 cases and the 2 throat swabs, the first one and 5 days later the second one, 2 throat swabs which were taken were made free. So the investigations that we require in our research projects, all 3 research projects, we gave the basic investigations that were done were the throat swab test on PCR and the C-reactive protein, the counts to tell about the lymphocytosis or neutrophilia, the hemodynamic balance of the body, for that hemoglobin and the volumes of the blood, as well depending on the presentation, the other needful investigations. These are the part of protocol as far as investigation is concerned. And mind you, sir, all these investigations are done free of cost to anyone who has either come in contact with a COVID positive patient or is COVID positive or has got influenza-like illness. So the other part is expense part is taken care by this fact that everything is subsidized by government, sir.
And mostly it is a mild to moderate illness, the patients are likely to be referred to our hospitals.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Up to moderate level, till the time they don't end up in sari, all these patients will come to our hospital, sir.
Okay, sir. And because the biggest fear that has been echoed by many emergency physicians the world over is that the development of the transition between moderate to severe is very abrupt, and the patient really gives no time. So that's why I was wondering.
You are very right, sir. You are very right, sir. The transition from moderate to severe, it seems, sir, in we don't yet have that primary experience, sir.
Right.
We don't have. All that we have with us are people who are COVID asymptomatic, or only one today who is admitted today is sneezing since morning. Very mild influenza-like illness. So our experience is this. Whereas the designated hospital experience, what I hear from the people working there is that it takes hardly some time for a moderate patient to turn out into sari. And the chance that one can take there is very minimal.
Right, sir. And even the personal protection equipments and all have been taken care by the government only, sir?
Yeah. Yes, sir. The kind of personal protection equipment that we have received from government are excellent, sir. They are made in Korea. Okay. The kind of layers they are there and the ease with which you can wear is wonderful. Of course, it is literally a punishment to wear for 4 hours in this hot summer. But yet, there were media reports that we heard that they were of not great quality, but what we have received at our center, they are wonderful quality. There is a specific protocol for everything in which the personnel who are using them are trained, sir. The protocol is like, for example, how to wash the floor. All these days we were mopping the floor, but how to wash the floor? To that too, how to wear the PPE, where to wear, where to remove, how to dispose it, how to dispose the disposed bag out. So for everything there is a protocol, and there is a checklist given. There is one small paper which is printed. There is a checklist. One has to keep a trace of the checklist. You have to simply tick every time.
Right.
So the amount of regimentation that has come up on that aspect is really wonderful. Wonderful. I don't have lot of to complain about that, sir.
Right, sir. And all the physicians are homeopaths only, whoever are posted in our hospital.
Sir, basically, there is a doctor who is otherwise called as the nodal doctor. He is the one who is in charge of it, who is a government allopathic doctor. He is an allopathic doctor, and he is the one, he or she, whomsoever it is, sir, he or she is the one who are in charge of this. This hospital is taken over by government. In fact, right now, I have also become a government employee, sir, as per the notification. Still, this COVID hospital remains. Well, the other side of it is that they have a fixed kind of treatment, sir. If fever occurs, if it crosses this degree to this degree, this is to be given, and after that, this has to be given. Everything is written down. For that, you don't require a doctor at all. A nurse is more than enough. Okay. Now, what we are waiting is the approval of the government of India to give our medicine. Till now, they have not given us this clearance. I am expecting it tomorrow evening, sir. So tomorrow evening, if at all we get, we will be treating these patients for ILI.
Okay.
Or those who are asymptomatic, we'll be treating from tomorrow.
Okay. And the drugs
further
be...
to that, yeah, the please. Government sir,
please,
the government please. Government is also perplexed. Government is also perplexed that the entire effort that is being done is neither against what ICMR has told as its protocol, neither they can simply give away permission. I hope you are understanding in between the lines.
Okay.
So, somewhere they are perplexed, sir. Tomorrow they are going to take a decision on this to give us independently responsibility to treat this ILI. I am told tomorrow they are going to take, sir.
Without the intervention of this nodal doctor.
That's what. Without the intervention of the nodal doctor, sir. Right now, the nodal doctor is intervened. You are hardly get the problem with us right now is that we hardly get any symptoms. You know, fever increases and then he gives one paracetamol, fever goes off.
Absolutely. Correct.
You don't know what to take as symptom.
Correct, sir. Correct, sir. And therapeutically, what is your mind about the treatment part, sir, as far as homeopathy is concerned, and what are the aims and objectives of this research protocol, sir?
Sir, there are three different the research projects that we have submitted are three different, sir. They are three different. One, number one is, see, when we have given a drug as prophylactic,
hello,
arsenical 30.
Now, this video call me laga.
This medicine, as far as our literature is concerned. Hello. Sir, the medicine which has worked as prophylaxis should also work as a therapeutic agent. This is one dictum that we have been studying since long. So, Arsenicum album 30 was given as prophylaxis. From my institution, we have given to 68,000 families, each family of average 5 people, sir. Now, 68 into 5, what figure comes, that's fine. So, we have given to this big number. So, whatever was the prophylactic drug should also work as the therapeutic drug. So, there is one different proposal that has gone for approval, where only arsenical 30 will be given, nothing else will be given.
Okay.
Hello, sir. So this is one project, sir. One project. There is another project where the pure homeopathic tenets of individualization, individualizing the patient, individualizing the drug, individualizing the potency, individualizing the dose and its repetition, everything is included, where there are two groups made, sir. One group where we could not do anything as far as homeopathy is concerned. Why? Because this our allopathic doctor intervened. So what happened with him, with his treatment, sir? And there is another group that we have taken up where we could individualize and treat accordingly. This is the other group. So this is the second study. We would like to compare the outcomes of these two groups. One which did not receive individualized homeopathic treatment, the other which received only individualized homeopathic treatment. These are two groups. So this is the second study, sir. The third study is, we have, as I shared that blog, wherein many drugs were given by different people individually as prophylactics at different in different parts of the world. Now, why we made a small list of our own, which included Arsenicum album, Gelsemium, Bryonia, Camphora, and lastly, Chininum Sulf. So these five drugs were taken. As a similar thing is being done at Neminath Homeopathic Medical College, Agra also. They have taken five drugs. So such a similar thing where we have taken five drugs. Five drugs only are being individualized and given to patients. This is a single arm study, sir. We are not, this third study, we are not doing it as a double arm study. It is a single arm study where only the efficacy of these five drugs and the result is being studied. So these are three research projects that have gone till now, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kulkarni, for the wonderful lecture and the hard pain that you have taken to arrive and procure these projects. We wish you all the best and wish you all success, and we hope you keep the flag of homeopathy high, and we would love to read more of your research projects being published very soon. I would request Dr. Sampatsa to come online.
I have a doubt from the audience side.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Anand Kulkarni, please, as I understand, as per your talk, so number one is independently homeopathic medicine, that is one study, and secondly Ajwan study, allopathic medicines are being given, and simultaneously homeopathic medicines are also given, and the third study is the people who are under the quarantine, may not be at your place, under quarantine, for them homeopathic medicines are being given. So these are the three types of the studies for which we can apply for the as the research studies. Am I right, Dr. Anand Kulkarni?
Sir, the third one, as you said, it is not about quarantine, sir. The third one is about only one drug, sir. One drug, okay. Because that was what was popularly given as a prophylactic.
Okay.
So, Arsenicum album was given as a prophylactic, sir. So since that was a prophylactic, why not it work as a therapeutic agent, sir? That was the third one, sir.
That I understand. So one COVID-19 positive patients. Okay, that is one study.
Yes, sir.
And second study.
No, sir. All three, sir. No, sir. All three.
You submitted these three studies to the government of India, that we understand. So the possibility of the studies for the audience also, okay, is it possible the quarantine study? Is it possible to have a study giving the mass distribution of the medicine and making a study because all of them, they are not close to the district authorities to get the permissions and all. So at their individual level, at their institution level, so any other studies, if they are available, they can think of. For that reason, I am asking you, Dr. Anand.
Certainly, sir. I have two, three small suggestions to make to think on those lines, sir. One very good study that can be taken up by an individual, sir. And my suggestion to HMAT is, as an organization, please have small changes in your bylaws and create one institutional ethics committee. Any member of HMAT can utilize that institutional ethics committee, because until unless you have institutional ethics committee, none of these work. Yeah. If you have, sir, that's wonderful. There is nothing like it. But institutional ethics committee has to be formed as per the guidelines, and it has to be registered, sir. So there are two, three suggestions that I have got to make, sir. Suggestion number one is, individually, many of us have distributed arsenic amal 30, sir. There is a small questionnaire, or there is not questionnaire, that's called format. There is a small format available on CCRH website, which is a small app kind of a thing. It's an app. In other words, it's an app. Sanjeevani, not exactly Sanjeevani, sir. Sanjeevani, what it does is, it tells about you individually, sir. It is an individual kind of app. Now, what I am trying to refer is a kind of app wherein if you take the mobile number of that person, the name is automatically entered. So, the number of people who have taken prophylaxis from you, their data, their at least the contact is generated automatically. So this will give a scope for us to know back after some time that whether they ever contacted COVID-19 or not. So this will show certain kind of efficacy that this prophylaxis has given, has shown insofar as the prevention of COVID-19 is concerned. This can be taken up by any practitioner anywhere, anytime. Number one. Number two is regarding the COVID care, not COVID care, the quarantine centers. Now, the quarantine centers have got people who are either primary, at the most secondary contacts, sir, who are not positive, who are not COVID positive. These are the people who probably require certain amount of immune-based boosting as claimed by Government of India. So, immune boosting, if you see around, I don't know, in Telangana, sir, I see everywhere else, Ayush means except the last H. There is so much of Ayurveda, homeopathy, nobody is bothered. You go to any quarantine center, they will give warm water, they will give kashaya, they will give chavanprash, they will give shamshamana vati, they will give another thing, what is that, to be put in the nose, some liquid,
oil.
Some oil to be put in nose. Pardon me, sir?
Oil and ghee. Pure ghee.
Must be, sir. Ghee or oil in the nose. All this is done except homeopathy. Except homeopathic drugs, which are part of the same advisory which tells all this to be done. So my suggestion is that the quarantine centers are fertile places for undertaking this kind of a study about what happened after the usage of the individualized homeopathic drugs or arsenic alb itself. Either of the both the things can be taken up. The third suggestion I have is that this entire COVID transmission, now the ICMR is thinking that we have reached community transmission. So this transmission, if at all it is true, then the transmission must be happening around the places around our practice, wherever we practice, around those areas it must be happening. So one questionnaire can be prepared wherein the data of people, what kind of suffering they had, what kind of changes they had over a period as far as their suffering were concerned, as well the symptoms that they might develop on a certain day tomorrow, and we may call them as COVID positive. This entire thing can be brought on a single sheet. This is a kind of survey and a study that any individual practitioner can be doing. Why? Because he or she sees so many people walking in, the patients as well as their relatives. At least we can maintain this data. Let us say around 200 to 300 people's data, one single practitioner, if he can maintain, if we can pull together some 20-30 doctors, then the numbers become big. They will give lot of insight into whether there is a real community spread, or if at all it is there, how is that happening? If at all it is happening, the course of development, which is so much important for us to understand what drug can be given either as preventive or curative, we will be coming to know. This is my suggestion, sir.
So, Dr. Anand here, Anand Rao Mingi from Hyderabad. Listen, Dr. Anand, it was a very good presentation on your behalf. I was just thinking over since last 1 hour, because Khurana sir also gave a good insight over the research projects and what to be done and what not to be done. He also gave a very beautiful research oriented speech. My question was, after the research which is being done now on the COVID positive or COVID suspected cases or wherever we are giving the homeopathic medicine, I am damn sure that homeopathy will have an upper hand and it will show the results which are more encouraging, as it was shown in previously also in swine flu or dengue or chikungunya or Ebola, whichever CCRH Ayush Corona sir told us. So how exactly should we use this data? Because we are, even though we have strong research oriented papers in the past, we have done very good things. Our homeopathic drugs are very effective. We are doing very well.
Dr. Anand, all these studies, whatever we have done, we were not having this type of protocol and research permitted studies. So this study, so that is the reason why what the Dr. Anand Kulkarni for the last 1 hour trying to emphasize was, so previously whatever the data that we have collected, we have not collected in a proper format and under the guidance of the proper authority. So when we are collecting the data under the guidance of the proper authority, by following a particular protocol and also by taking the proper permission. So this is the core. So that is the reason why for giving as an adjuvant medicine or independently, you need to take the permission from the government of India and also from the ICMR branches, that CTMR, I hope. So from that you are taking the permission apart from the government of India ICE department. So naturally you are getting covered. So your papers on the COVID-19, if the proper protocol is followed, so it is not going a waste. So as the BCT was a waste, I mean waste in the sense, though it has given very good recognition and very good relief to the people, but they have not considered the ICMR did not consider that as a proper study. So now we are going in a proper framework. The whole effort of today's webinar was focusing mainly on, so what is the proper protocol to be followed and how to apply, where to apply, so how to consolidate this data. So these efforts are being made. This is my view about the question of Dr. Anand Benzi. Am I right, Dr. Anand Kulkarni? Please.
You are perfect.
Doctor, do you find any role for the common homeopath? What should be the role of a common homeopath during this pandemic? Because we feel that as if we are helpless.
Dr. Anand Kulkarni has given you an idea. So you can have two roles to play there. Number one is,
no, we don't feel any that we feel that we don't have any role now.
Once again, I am telling
you, as a common practitioner, do you feel that a homeopath has any role? Because whatever you have said, it's a data collection. Data collection for something else.
Sir,
and in one line, Dr. Kulkarni, in one line,
that. 1 minute. Sir, 1 minute time. Yeah,
either you speak or let others speak.
Sir, let me.
See, my point is only that, do you feel that a common homeopath, does he have any role? And if that, what should it be? See, it should add to what you're doing. Or whatever you're doing, it should come back to us, to a common homeopath, so that he uses that particular knowledge in the years to come? So that's a simple question I have for you.
Yes, sir. I have probably simpler answer to this, sir, if it suits. Sir, a common homeopath, I don't see helpless, sir, honestly to tell you, because a common homeopath is the one who gets the kind of patients nobody gets, sir. So the kind of public rapport a common homeopath has, institutions we dream of, frankly to tell you. Sir, I was telling some 2-3 small projects, sir. One among them was that why don't we get a common homeopath individually alone gets tied up with a quarantine center. A quarantine center is a place where COVID negative people are there who require the kind of treatment as well as attention is needed, because I don't know, we have not used this word, sir, COVID-19 has become a stigma now. Anybody who is even considered to be nearby to a COVID-19 person is considered to be a stigma to society. This is where a common homeopath comes into role, sir. A study can be done about the people who were quarantined and what effects this quarantining itself has created on them, sir. As well, whether we have boosted their immunity, whether we could boost their immunity. Why? Because they were the ones who were primary contacts to the COVID positive patients. So I feel a common homeopath can do very well here, sir. Number one. Let me complete, sir. I have one more thing to speak on this.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, numbers, as far as my understanding goes, sir, world works on numbers. People are interested in numbers. Everybody else talks about 80%, 90%. People are interested in these percentages, numbers and all. People are not interested in, say, if somebody says that I am very proficient in something. The proficiency is always, shown in numbers. So numbers are something a common homeopath can generate. Nobody else can generate, sir. This is my understanding. Number three is, sir, whatever this all effort is being done, sir, it will come back only to a common homeopath. Why? Because ultimately it will be translated. Hope so, one day it will be translated in our change, in the change of our perception. How we perceive all this, how we perceive an epidemic, how we perceive the fear psychosis this epidemic has created in the society, how do we perceive our role, how do we perceive the attitude of the authorities, how do we understand, how can we change that attitude for what we perceive as right? So this entire thing is what ultimately coming back to a common homeopath. Because COVID-19 may be an epidemic today, sir, there is no guarantee we'll not have COVID-20 or 21. We don't know. So there can be such a situation in future also. These are stepping stones, learning stones, sir, which we have failed to do all these years. This is an opportunity for us to catch up with anybody else. My submission, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Kulkarni.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, Dr. Anand Kulkarni, again for your enthusiasm and frank discussion of ideas and disseminating knowledge. Dr. Geeta Deshmukh, I think unwittingly you have shared your screen. Would you mind putting that off? I request Sampat Rao, sir, to take over, sir.
Anand. With 2-3 like-minded people, can you prepare number one, you are telling about the questionnaire to be prepared and can be collected from the people around our clinics, number one. Number two, you are also telling about preventive medicines are to be given and the
I mean, to whom we are giving, if their phone number, if we are going to take, and afterwards, if we are going to take the report, then a data is going to be created, number two. And also regarding two, three projects, what you have already prepared, to whom to approach, how to approach. So all these things, will it be possible to, make a write-up, and so that we can send it across our participants, thereby they will be enriched, and whatever the position that they are in, so with the help of this write-up, so they may take it to the next level. This is my submission. Will it be possible? And if it is possible, within how much time we can...
Sir, the remaining things like itself, the clearances that we have got on WhatsApp, sir, I can forward it. But the write-up, sir, kindly don't mind. It will take little time for me to prepare, sir. Because this COVID care center is at 24/7, 365 duty, sir. So I'll try to make it in a day or two, sir. Anyways, you know Praveen, sir, I will give him the rubrics in which he has to work. He will prepare in a day or two. I'll finalize and I'll give it to you in a day or two, sir.
So that is wonderful, Dr. Anand Kulkarni. All the participants are once again requested to leave their email IDs, and whatever the information that we are getting from any corner, so we will be promising on behalf of the Hyderabad Homeopathic Medical Association of Telangana. So we will be sending through your email. Dr. Venu, please.
Thank you, Dr. Anand Kulkarni. Again, I request our treasurer and medical director, Dr. Gopal Krishnagaru, to give concluding remarks and vote of thanks.
Before that, anybody is having any issue, any question, please ask, and thereby we can cut. Any questions, any queries from anybody? If no one is having any question, then we can ask our medical director and the treasurer of Homeopathic Medical Association of Telangana, Dr. Gopalakrishna Garu, to for the word of thanks.
Dr. Venugopal Gauri, can you speak for 1 minute? Hello?
Please go ahead, sir. Please introduce yourself, sir.
I am Dr. Ravinder, retired scientific officer from CCMB Hyderabad.
Thank you, sir. Please go ahead.
So this was regarding your question of nosode of COVID-19. So according to the one of the latest reports, COVID-19 nosode is already available. Because this I have come across in in an article by Ajit Kulkarni, and its website is viahomeopathica.com. You can see that. They have given 3 nosodes in that one. So regarding this plan of treatment and other prophylaxis things, so I feel that it's better we distribute this into among 3 different classes. The first one will be under people who are under quarantine, where you can give whatever homeopathic prophylaxis we are recommending to them. And that should not be a problem, because though most of them are home quarantine, or some quarantine centers are there where they'll be easily approachable through some mediators, whatever that nodal officer Dr. Kulkarni was talking about. And another group can become as an asymptomatic thing. Still, these people also can be treated as a prophylaxis treatment. So only that last group, which are having the positive symptomatic patients, these should be taken up by the concerned homeopathic group. Are taking the individualization of the patients and other things. And another thing we should keep in mind is all these people who have been gone through all this asymptomatic phase, or even the symptomatic phase, should be thoroughly be monitored and given some no-sode at one particular time point so that it should not relapse and even to spread to the others. So these, the what no-sode to be given and which miasmatic thing it falls under has to be decided by a group of doctors, learned people or who are experts in those fields, has to be taken up. Because according to the miasmatic classification, the symptoms coming in the initial stages were said that it's predominantly psoric miasmic. And the second phase, they say it's mostly psychotic, soropsychotic type. And third phase was tubercular phase. And where their degeneration has set in, they say the predominant has gone to syphilitic phase. So based on the to which level this patient has undergone the changes, that particular no-sode or the predominant no-sode has to be recommended, and then so that it should not be relapsed or further spread to the other people. So this was my observation about these things.
Sir, is this no-sode being is this no-sode being tested? Or
so no sir, this is not clinical trials on this one.
Then how do you want? How do you advise that to be given to a patient?
No, this I did not tell to give it to the patient.
Yeah.
Dr. Venugopal Gowri has asked for a no-sode. I said that COVID-19 no-sode is already there.
That's it.
Neither yes. Any medicine before giving, it should be proved.
Of course, Vashish sir. Dr. Ravinder is on our ethics committee, as you know, sir. And he's been always of help to us whenever, we require to make a presentation or as far as microbiology and the biochemistry is concerned, he's on our list of the first callers and he's always obliging. And in fact, when we wrote to ICMR twice in the last 10 days, Dr. Ravinder Garu has been of great help to us as to how to frame the letter one. Number two, also because the virus is very labile and he has suggested all you need is a viral coat, inactivated virus, and the you don't need the whole virus. If at all, as Dr. Khuranaji was saying, if you ask for a virus, you will never get it. That's why Dr. Ravinder suggested that, if it is an inactivated virus and you keep it for some time and test it, and if there's nothing coming out of it, you can still go ahead and use it for the no-sode. And also, to make a no-sode, all you need is a viral coat wherein that is how the body identifies and makes an antibody against, at least in the biochemical sense of the term. And that way, Dr. Ravinder has been of a great help to us. And he is a great lover of homeopathy. That's why he has also read about homeopathy and shared his inputs. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay, sir.
May I add one sentence here, sir?
Yes.
Sir, may I add one sentence
Please, Dr. Kulkarni, the floor is always yours.
Sir, regarding the no-sode, which the distinguished scientist was telling us, there is already a no-sode that is prepared in Bangalore and proving is going on, sir. It is now, I suppose, the 9th day. If I am right, today is 9th day that proving is going on. And we are waiting for the result of that proving. Funnily, or I don't know what should be the right metaphor that should be used here, this is prepared by a nephrologist, validated by a microbiologist, and then it is being formulated by a virologist. And there are homeopaths involved in it, sir. But that work is, proving part is going on, sir. We should hear from them as early as possible. And this entire thing is happening under the aegis of ICMR. It is not happening on individual level or somebody's personal level. It is happening under ICMR's aegis. So, similar attempt is also going on at Ahmedabad, Gujarat. That is the second place where it is happening. So these two will take little time to come up with exact data, but what proving we talk, that is really going on. This is an addendum, sir. Sorry to interrupt.
Thank you. No, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Request other participants, if you have any question, we can take one more question as it is the end of the day. And if you have any, or we'll have Dr. Gopal Krishna Garu to sum up the evening.
Dr. Gopal Krishna, please.
Dr. Sampatra, Dr. Venugopal. I am Dr. Gopal Krishna. On behalf of Homeopathic Medical Association of Telangana, I would propose a vote of thanks. I thank Dr. Khurana for his very informative and very impressive deliberation. And I also thank Dr. Anand Kulkarni for his very detailing and efforts taking endeavor. We profusely thank you, sir. And we also wish you all success in your research endeavors. And we wish the outcome would be a very great one, and which would be helpful for the posterity in the spread of homeopathy for the benefit of mankind. And in organizing this event, our organizing committee members, our president, Dr. Sampath Rao, our general secretary, Dr. Venugopal Gowri, we profusely thank. And we thank all the patient participation and hearing. And before we conclude this session, I request you all to stand for national anthem at the end.
You are all unmuted, and for the national anthem, please go ahead. Jai 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 Jai